Most more potential for a long time. Touch gone.
Versus Vincent Fagan Boots. Let's talk about the fight. This was Caleb's second defense of the IBF super middleweight title, and much like his previous defense of the title, there were no surprises here.
Nope.
I felt like, you know, Vincent, he's a strong puncher, no doubt about it, but he's lacking in too many other areas to make this interesting, make this competitive, much less win the fight. I did go with Caleb to win this thing, and that's very much what he did, because Caleb is a talented guy, for what it's worth. I mean, you guys know that I'm not a fan of the PBC's business practices, but Caleb really is one of their more talented fighters. I want to say that Caleb very much looked the part here as the reigning and defending champion, effectively going up top and downstairs on Vincent, hitting him on both sides, mixing up the punches, outmaneuvering the very limited and predictable puncher in Vincent Fagan Boots. You know, I think that Vincent's heart was in it. It's just that he was lacking in too many other areas to make this a competitive match. That, you know, when you're in there with a finesse fighting kind of guy like Caleb, you've got to be able to cut the ring off and cut it off effectively to get within range of that guy and force him into a firefight, force him into situations.
He couldn't do it.
I said this ahead of the fight. I didn't think Vincent had the legs for the job.
He couldn't do it.
Do think he exhibited some wherewithal. I think that even though the fight got stopped in the 10th, Vincent had two more rounds in him. He did. I mean, I think he could have made it to the final bell. It's just, there's a question of made it to the final bell to do what exactly? Be on the receiving end of more of Caleb's punches? You tell yourself that you think the guy could have went on, but went on to do what exactly?
Yeah.
Continue to lose the fight? Because it was a clean sweep on my card. In truth, I think it was a good showing for Caleb, albeit a predictable one. There was very little intrigue associated with this fight, at least for me. Similar to Caleb Plant's previous engagement with Mike Lee. He's a cut above these guys. And you know that coming in. You know that Caleb's going to dominate this guy. And the most intriguing fight for Caleb at this point in the juncture would be a fight with the guy that he decided to call out post-fight. Talking about David Benavidez. David Benavidez, who is more physically adept for the task and has the kind of skill set that a Vincent Fagan Boots doesn't have. Understand that David Benavidez has been in there with a very skillful mover and puncher, similar to Caleb Plant, though not identical, but better still, David Benavidez has been in there with a guy who's mobile, who tries to fight on the go, who tries to stick and move. And that guy is Anthony Doral, the guy who he had to beat to get his world title back. So he has those kinds of experiences to bring to the table in regards to a Caleb Plant fight, which is a very intriguing matchup. You think about David Benavidez, his generous dimensions for the weight, the fact that he's a little bigger than Caleb Plant, but he's no lumbering lummox, that this is a guy with ring savvy and ring IQ of his own. Devastating punching power. His experience is ahead of what would be a Caleb Plant fight. That not only has he been in there with a hit and not get hit, stick and move kind of guy in Anthony Doral, but he's also been in there with a tough nut to crack in Ronald the Thrill Gavril. Those two fights. You know, Ronald Gavril, he's never been stopped. He's got a chin, that guy. Might have lost three fights, two of them to David Benavidez, but he's never been stopped.
David beat him two times.
One could argue that perhaps David Benavidez has fought a slightly better quality of competition. If we're comparing Jose Uscatecki to Anthony Durrell, if we're comparing either a Mike Lee or a Vincent Fagenbuchs to the likes of a Ronald the Thrill Gavril, one could make the argument that David has fought a slightly better quality of competition, though when it comes to a fight with Caleb Plant, there really are no foregone conclusions. And if anything really resonates with me when it comes to this past weekend's fight involving Caleb and Vincent, it's that, you know, I want to see Caleb in there with the big dogs at 168. That's what I want to see the most, because these kinds of guys, they ain't got nothing for Caleb. It's going to take a fight with a David Benavidez for him to really cross over and show his true quality. I think the same is true in reverse. It's going to take for David to remove Caleb Plant's O to really put on full display how good he really is. I mean, essentially what I'm getting at is these two guys, they got to fight. They've got to fight, okay? They're on the same side of the street. So nix the politics of boxing crap. These guys have got to fight. And I'm just hoping that at some point this year, we get to see it. Because even though, you know, you got guys that are on the same side of the street, sometimes fights don't happen. You know, Gary Russell, he hasn't fought Leo Santa Cruz yet, has he? No, he hasn't. And Keith Thurman, he never did get around to fighting Errol Spence. Now, did he? No, he didn't. So there are no guarantees. But I'm just hoping that when it comes to this match, we actually get to see it. Because Caleb let it be known that he wants that fight. And I'm sure that David wants to oblige him. That's really what resonates with me the most in regards to Caleb's fight this weekend, that I want to see him in there with David Benavidez. Now, when it comes to this weekend's fights, and the one that really resonated with me the most, it was the one that lasted the shortest amount of time.
One round.
The one that didn't go past the first round. I'm talking about King Ryan Garcia's fight with Francisco Fonseca. I haven't been this floored by an up-and-comer since I saw Teofimo Lopez knock out Richard Comey in all of one round. I mean, this knockout really had that kind of wow factor that even if you felt that Ryan should win the fight and win the fight comfortably, you weren't quite expecting it to end so abruptly and in such sensational fashion. Ryan Garcia literally caught this guy between the one and the two. That is, this guy's going to fire off the two, Ryan Garcia plants a very compact left hook that ends this fight in spectacular fashion. I mean, here you got Francisco Fonseca firing off his jab to set up his right hand. Good old 1-2. And as he's letting that jab go, Ryan Garcia turns over one of the more compact hooks I've ever seen. I mean, this thing was airtight. Short, crisp, and to the point. There's not much room and not much time for you to do anything but get hit by it the way that Francisco Fonseca got hit by it. It was a beautiful left hook.
Sensational.
Thereby allowing Ryan Garcia to make even shorter work of Francisco than Tevin Farmer did, who fought Francisco Fonseca to a decision, and make shorter work of Francisco than Javante did, who took about 8 or 9 rounds to get this guy out of there. Now understand something, folks. Ryan Garcia dispatching Francisco sooner than those guys did, it's not an insight into those fights, because as we all know, triangle theories don't work in boxing. Just because Ryan beat Francisco faster than those guys did doesn't mean that's an insight into what a fight with him and them would look like. It's a different fight entirely because they're different fighters. There's enough evidence of this in the sport of boxing that triangle theories don't work, like Taylor, Hopkins, and Pavlik, or Ali, Frazier, and Foreman, or the more contemporary Joshua, Parker, and Ruiz. That triangle theories really don't work. But if this highlight reel knockout communicated something about Ryan Garcia, it is that he is on the level, more or less. That if there is an expectation of him to beat a certain kind of opponent, he can meet it. In fact, he can exceed it, because he beat this guy faster than two world champions beat this guy in defense of what were their titles. So what this communicates is that Ryan is on the level. And what is the level? What does that mean exactly? Well, ahead of Tevin Farmer's fight with Francisco Fonseca, you guys out there, you expected Tevin to beat this guy more or less, didn't you?
Right.
You expected him to beat him in some form of fashion, whether it's by a stoppage or a wide points decision. You did expect that at the end of the fight, Tevin Farmer would have his hand raised.
Yeah.
That's what happened.
Yeah.
And the same is true of the Gervonta Davis fight, more or less, right? I mean, you guys expected that Gervonta Davis should be able to beat this guy. That's what you expected, and that's what happened. That expectation is the bar of standard. That is the level that ahead of Ryan Garcia's fight with this same guy that they fought, the expectation is that Ryan should be able to beat this guy. That is, if he's progressing and improving and he is to become an elite-level fighter, the expectation is he should be able to beat this guy, and he did more than that. He starched the guy, okay? First-round knockout. Beautiful stuff. You don't usually expect a fighter with Ryan Garcia's dimensions, which are very generous for the lightweight division. What's this kid, about 5'10", 70-inch reach? You don't expect a lanky fighter to be able to throw these kinds of short, compact hooks with that much speed and accuracy. I mean, Ryan Garcia really is coming along. Because I'll tell you something, those kinds of compact hooks, the kind that are Ryan Garcia planted on Francisco, those kinds of hooks are more characteristic of what you see from a smaller, stumpier fighter with shorter arms. Because they got shorter arms, there's less room in there to catch the guy between the punches. Whereas Ryan Garcia is a very statuesque 5'10", 70-inch reach. For the lightweight division, those are very generous proportions. Yet in spite of this, Ryan Garcia's hook was airtight. Beautiful.
Effective.
This denotes what I was saying ahead of this fight in several other videos regarding Ryan Garcia, that this kid really is improving where a fighter like Gervonta Davis is regressing. For Gervonta, the expectation was that he should be able, emphasis on should,
yeah,
that he should be able to make short work of a guy on the ass end of his career like Yuriorkis Gamboa, that there's not much reason for this fight to go more than a couple of rounds because of Yuriorkis Gamboa's state and what is to be the level of a Gervonta Davis, but that fight went the distance. Whereas with Ryan, you know, you expect that he should beat Francisco Fonseca. You do. But you don't imagine that he's going to dispatch him quite as easily
as that
as he did. That shows that Ryan is on the level and improving. And his next test will be against the former three-division champion,
El Niño de Oro,
Jorge Linares. I think that's a fantastic fight, a sensational fight. Jorge racked up a victory of his own on that same card. He looked the part in his fight. And I said it before, I very much like the idea of a Ryan Garcia versus Jorge Linares fight because that's the necessary process a young fighter has to go through. You gotta fight these tough guys that have their own skills, their own ring savvy and attributes that they bring to the table. You know, most people aren't aware of this, but Jorge Linares has one of the better right hands anywhere at 135, okay? You know, the casual observer likely only knows Jorge for having been the one to drop Vasyl Lomachenko upon his ascent to the lightweight division, not realizing that, you know, Jorge was one of the key players at 135, having beaten Mercito Gesta, beaten Anthony Crolla two times, beaten Luke Campbell, an Olympic gold medalist. That's the same Luke Campbell that just gave Vasyl Lomachenko a very hard fight, gave a good account of himself in spite of having lost. Well, Jorge beat that guy in 2017. At lightweight, Jorge is a very formidable fighter. The same is not true at 140, you understand, where he was starched by a journeyman in Pablo Cano. These things happen, but, you know, I reiterate, at 135, this guy can be a handful, and for a young up-and-comer like Ryan Garcia, this is the adequate litmus test for Ryan Garcia to cross over from being a prospect to a legitimate, bona fide, world-level contender. This is what it takes. I know that there's some demand, some intrigue associated with a Ryan Garcia versus Devin Haney fight.
I get it.
I understand that demand. I mean, they're two of the most promising young fighters in the lightweight division today, anywhere at or around this weight class. So I understand the desire to see these two guys lock horns. I get it. I get it completely.
But let's be honest.
Them two guys aren't going to fight each other no time soon.
Nope.
I'm not expecting them to.
Nope.
I never expected them to. Try and understand. Devin Haney is a little further in his career.
Further along.
Than Ryan is in his. You know, Devin Haney can at least say that he was a world champion, albeit for a very short while, he can say that, whereas for Ryan, this is something that he is still aspiring to do.
But hasn't yet.
And this would explain why most of the enthusiasm you're seeing in regards to that fight is coming from the Haney side of things, because Haney and his people, they feel ready for Ryan, whereas I'm not sure the same is true on Ryan's end of things. Now, I'm not telling you that it's right, I'm not telling you that it's wrong, I'm just telling you what it is, I'm giving it to you straight, that don't hold your breath waiting to see Ryan Garcia fight Devin Haney anytime in the near future, because that's not going to happen. What is going to happen, in all likelihood, is that Devin Haney will challenge the winner of Luke Campbell versus Javier Fortuna for the WBC title. That's what's more likely than not to happen, because Devin Haney is a champion in recess. Whoever wins that fight, regardless of who it is, they owe Devin a shot at the WBC title. That's what you're more likely to see in the near future. When it comes to Ryan, hey, we just discussed what's in the near future for him, a Jorge Linares fight.
I mean, I understand wanting to see him fight. I'm just saying that it's not realistic and it's not going to happen. If that's what your expectations are, you're going to be disappointed, because I don't see that happening this year or next year. I don't.
These two young guys, they're not really maturated fighters like a Crawford and a Spence or a Wilder and a Joshua or a Bivol and a Beterbiev or a Smith and a Saunders or a Plant and a Benavidez. These two young kids, they're not even there yet.
They're nowhere near.
If those two guys fought right now, what would it be for? What would be on the line, you know? It's not like Shakur Stevenson and Josh Warrington, to where, yes, Shakur is a very young fighter, but he's a world champion, and so is Josh, and in that way, it's a high-stakes unification fight. This situation doesn't mirror that one, so for what reason would Golden Boy attempt to orchestrate that kind of a fight here and now? Would make absolutely no sense to them. Y'all saw the video of both Devin Haney and his father demanding that Bernard Hopkins make the fight between Devin and Ryan. But for all the sound bites and all the footage, I don't expect to see that thing anytime in the near future, if at all. I just don't, and I'm being honest. I think in all likelihood, Devin Haney could soon outgrow the 135-pound division.
2-3 fights.
At least before you see him lock horns with Ryan Garcia. I think 2-3 fights from now, we could see Devin moving up to the 140-pound division. Whilst Ryan continues to make his bones at 135. That's what I think is more likely to happen than not.
So, I mean, I don't know what to tell you, but Ryan's still on the bring-along process. We all know it, and, you know, that's okay. I mean, most fighters go through the bring-along process to spark growth, continued growth in gradual progression and measured risks.
That's how it goes.
Because right here and now, a Devin Haney fight would be more trouble than it's worth. So, you know, whether you like it or not, don't look for that fight to happen in the near future, because it won't.